explain this to you.
Go on, then.
If I don't unload this today, it goes solid. And if your men are prepared to shovel it out when it goes solid, fair enough. Now, if I can deliver it, fair enough, and I shan't come to war.
Well, surely,
Morris Black Oil and it goes solid.
Surely, your national officials know that goes solid. And they're the people who's leading you.
Yeah.
They've given us 100% support and told us that if we approach drivers in a proper manner, that those drivers will support our strike.
We're sorry for it, Bill, that you were aware of your union's instructions there, that you were not to break the picket lines, weren't you?
Well, this is all we're asking. We're asking you to go back.
I'll be fair with you. Can I deliver it this once on a shuttle?
No. We're keeping a continual picket line on these two gates. Well, look, this gate and the west gate.
Let me pull through. I'll park on that side. So I can turn around here and I'll walk around to the telephone.
Just a minute.
I shan't.
The decision is his.
I shan't return.
You've had your talk with him. Yeah. The decision is his now. Now, just clear the way.
Well, look here, sir.
If he wants to take it in, it's up to him.
The miners on strike last year. Since then, gas workers, railway men, hospital worker, and the only question is who strikes next. But another question raised by these strikes is, should the state give financial support to the families of men who decide to withdraw their labour? For instance, it is calculated that in 1972, £7 million was paid out to the families of men on strike. Some Conservative MPs have long felt that the only way to combat strike is to take tougher action. And one MP, Ralph Howell, is responding to this growing feeling inside his party by introducing a private member's bill to stop supplementary benefit being paid to the families of men on strike. And to question him on the broader aspects of the bill are Joe Ashton, Labour MP, and three people who could be on the receiving end. Cynthia Brailsforth, Irene Hughes, who are wives of Kentish miners, and Pauline Leith, who is a postman's wife. Ralph Howell, why did you decide to present a bill in Parliament to stop benefits being paid to the families of men on strike? And what effect do you expect it to have?
I've introduced this bill because I think it quite wrong that the community at large and people who are being inconvenienced and sometimes endangered by strikes should be compelled by the government to subsidise strikers and their dependents while they're on strike. This has only occurred in this massive way since the 1966 legislation. Prior to that, very little was paid by the state to miners and their dependents, and in fact as late as 1968, before the claimants' union had discovered how to use this legislation, less than £500,000 was paid out to strikers and their dependents. But since then, this figure has escalated to £9.5 million in 1972. And I feel that it is very wrong that the general public, and in particular the lower paid people, the pensioners, and the who are in fact the ex-workers, should be forced to help people who are much better off than they are themselves. And it is in the main that the better paid people who are involved in strike action, I think it is quite wrong that people who are unable to spare this money are being forced to contribute.
But before we open it up, there's a lot of points there to be taken up, and I'd like to take up a couple myself first before I open it out. First of all, do you consider that strikers are in fact taxpayers?
Everybody's a taxpayer.
So in fact, in the 1906 Supplementary Benefits Commission, when they decided that people should get benefits of right, that meant everybody, strikers, families as well. So isn't your bill then a step backwards instead of forward?
Not at all. In fact, my bill, I believe, would strengthen the unions themselves and make them, the responsible union management would be in a much stronger position if they were responsible, as they should be, for paying out of their union funds maintenance to their members when on strike.
But aren't you just getting away, though, I mean, without bringing the unions in for the moment, the 1966 Supplementary Benefits Act said that people could have in having hardship could get benefits as of right.
Yes.
Now, are you going to say, are you saying that that concept is wrong and you want to go back now to the 1948 days when we had the National Assistance Board?
Yes. There's no need to use the word National Assistance Board. We can carry on talking about Social Security. What I'm saying is the 1966 legislation was wrong, and a big mistake was made. I'm sure that the Socialist government didn't do this intentionally, but a way of using this legislation has been discovered since. And I maintain that Supplementary Benefits Commission should not be involved in paying out benefit to any striker. Strikers are employed people, and other employed people can and sometimes do squander their money before they look after their wives and children.
Just one point I'd like to take up with you. I don't think the benefits are in fact paid to the striker. They are in fact paid to the families of the striker. And so how can you implement a bill like yours without hardship to the families of the striker?
Let me just correct you. They are paid to the striker for the families, and also in some cases to the striker himself.
Mm.
But I have the figures. 192,000 was paid out last year to strikers themselves, and the rest, over 9 millions, to their dependents. So, of course, if any bill which stopped payment to the strikers would be thoroughly ineffective, because the great majority of this money is being paid to the strikers for their families.
And you don't think there's going to be any damage or hardship to the wives and children if you take away these benefits?
You really must look upon unions as...
No, I'm not talking about the unions.
Well, you can't talk about this subject without talking about the unions sensibly. Any union is in every respect similar to an insurance company. If you insure your house and it burns down, you don't go to the government to claim funds, you go to the insurance company, who rightfully pay out. The union is just the same. Now, Mr.
Howell, before I must give it over to Joe Ashton now, I just cannot understand this attitude of you pushing it over to the unions. Let's leave the unions alone for a minute or two. We are taxpayers. We pay into the government taxes. The government has set up a supplementary commission, benefits commission, mm-hmm. and therefore, as of right, we can claim benefits. You are going to take the benefits away.
Yes. Just a moment. I am saying that that a striker is an employed person in every sense. He has an employer. He has his cards lodged with him, and he has voluntarily stopped work, just as an absentee sometimes does. Now, an absentee, the Supplementary Benefits Commission is not empowered to give any money to a person who absents himself from work. And what is the difference between an absentee and a striker?
Well, I think Joe Ashton will bring you in there. Your reaction to the bill, please, and at any point...
Well, it's not fair, and it won't work. For instance, why single out strikers for this? Why not say that a man in prison, for instance, who's perhaps been sentenced to 10 years for mugging or something such as that, why should we keep his wife and kids? After all, going on strike's not a crime. Mm. And mugging is. Now, what you're saying is that strikers' wives and children shall be punished for the actions of their fathers or husbands, but that somebody, a man who goes to prison, his wife and family won't. Again, you can take the principle even further on these lines and say that a man who refuses a job refuses to work for a certain amount of money is on strike. Let's take an actor who was offered a job at, say, £10 a week in repertory. And he says, look, £10 a week is no good. I can't live on it. In effect, he's saying, I'm not going to work for that money. In effect, he is on strike. Therefore, are you going to turn round and say, well, then his wife and kids aren't going to get any supplementary benefit because he's refusing to work for that money? And where do you end this principle?
Well, Joe, again, to you I say, just as I said to Mr. Howell that I feel that as of right, families should get benefits. To you I say, what about the unions and what part should they play? Well, haven't they a responsibility towards the families?
Of course, the unions do have strike funds. But let's be honest, you take a union like the hospital workers where they're on very low pay. The most they can be expected to pay as a weekly contribution is about £2, £10, something like that. How much strike fund can you build up on that? And what will happen, of course, is that if Mr. Howell's bill was to go through, the unions would just simply dissolve their strike funds in any case, or you'd get far more unofficial strikes. where the heads of the union were saying, go back to work, and the men on the shop floor were saying, we're not, and would in effect break the union's rules. You'd have far more mavericks and wildcats.
But nevertheless,
sort of
nevertheless, I mean, there are unions, aren't there, that are much richer than the hospital workers. Why did they withhold their strike pay? I mean, are they abusing it, as Mr. Howell has said? Are they deliberately abusing the 1966 Act?
No, what happened in a year ago, or 2 years ago, Sir Keith Joseph altered what's known as a disregard, a very long word, but what it meant was that you could earn or receive £4 a week without it affecting supplementary benefit. They then cut that to £1 a week, hoping that it would solve this problem. But it made it worse, because then unions simply told their members to go and claim Social Security. Now, we've had an Industrial Relations Act last year, 155 clauses, 288 pages, and this clause wasn't one of them. Because Sir Keith Joseph and the government have examined this every way they can think of. And if there was a way to stop it, a practical way, then they would have done.
Can I just put this point forward to both of you, that in fact, you brought up the Industrial Relations Bill, which I don't want to go into, no. But that antagonised a lot of the unions, didn't it, Mr. Howell? Do you feel that your bill might also add to this and cause more militancy?
No, I don't think so. As I said before, I believe that if my bill were put into operation, then the responsible union management, and there are lots of responsible union managers who are being pushed around by the militants further down for the simple reason that it doesn't matter who, they don't have to open up the union money bags for maintenance for strikers anymore since the 66 legislation. Social Security will pay. Any irresponsible person in a union can call a strike against the management, as so often happens. Now, if, and furthermore, since it doesn't matter whether the union is in funds or not, therefore, there's less reason to belong to a union. If we reverted to the position as it was during the lifetime of the last socialist government, when so little was paid out, if we reverted to that position, it would be more necessary and worthwhile for a person to belong to a union. The unions would be stronger. And they would be able to fulfil their proper function instead of being pushed around by a bunch of militants as they are at the present time.
Well, at this point, I'd like to bring in the wives who that we've got in the studio who have been involved with strikes and know what it's like to be on strike. So, first of all, let's get an idea of what living on supplementary benefit is really like for a long period of time. Cynthia, you're a miner's wife. How long were you on strike?
9 weeks we were on strike.
And how much benefit a week did you get?
I can't remember offhand, but I think it was about £11, I think.
Well, just you have five children,
I've got
Cynthia.
Five children, yes.
What were the main difficulties for you living during that strike?
The food, I think. The meat and milk. Milk I had to cut down on, which I didn't like to do. And meat and cheese and things like that, we had to cut right down. Very hard. The children
what about you, Irene? What kept you going during the strike? Do you have any children?
No, I haven't any children, but we didn't get any benefits at all anyway, because my husband went in once or twice, you know, for the safety.
At the pit?
Yes.
And did that mean then he wasn't liable for benefits?
Mm-hmm.
So what did you do?
Well, we just had to cut down on everything, you know. Even on potatoes.
And did you have to sort of live on any money you got put back?
Yes, yes.
Pauline, your strike, in fact, caused a lot of public sympathy because yours is not a terribly rich union.
No.
How did you cope during financially during the strike?
Well, you just existed, really, didn't you? I had £8. I have three sons, but only one qualified, you see. My husband didn't get any benefit. He had to claim the benefit for myself and my son. No, it was worse, really, than when we were rationed just after the war, because everything had to be meted out. It's a dreadful existence on strike pay.
How easy is it to get benefit? I mean, do you just walk along and say, my husband's on strike?
No, the man fetches
them. When we were on strike, they told us what day you would go to Dover, which was, 8 miles from where we live. You had certain days for a certain, ABC was a certain day, and my husband went. And you were in a room, there was about 200 men in there. And you queued up down one length of chairs, and as it kept moving up down another length, then they call you to a counter and They want to know the ins and outs of everything. We had to produce our rent book, our family allowance book, and our bank book, which didn't have very much in it.
Can I? What's your attitude to strikes, Cynthia? I mean, you know, you've got kids, and it's a long time. Do you feel about strikes?
Nobody likes strikes. I don't like strikes. We've only had one. And as I say, I voted this morning for strike action again. But it's not because you want to go on strike, but it's the only thing the working man's got left, is to strike.
Do you think you should have supplementary benefits? Do you think that Mr. Howell's bill...
I definitely do. There's thousands of people come into Great Britain every year, and Social Security are waiting to greet them to hand out supplementary benefits. Our men have paid taxes and insurance, I don't know how long, and they've claimed once. If my husband goes on strike this time, I've got 5 children, and I shall put them in care, because I won't be able to keep them.
But what are the strike funds for?
But what strike funds?
I'm talking about the miners' strike fund. Now, if I can come in here. During the miners' strike, $5.5 million was paid out in this one strike in supplementary allowances. Now, if you relate this to the fact that only £400,000 in total was paid out in 1968, and there were quite a lot of strikes in 1968, you can get the size of this thing. 208 special officers were set up to pay this money out. 14,000 man weeks were put in by officials to pay this money out. No effective check could be conducted in the situation which existed during the miners' strike. Are you trying to tell me that the miners' funds, which amount to many millions, should remain intact while pensioners are being forced to contribute through taxation, and pensioners do pay tax in everything they buy.
You're very
just a minute, Joe, let's finish.
No, I'm not. Let's face this thing fairly and squarely. Can it be right that the funds which the Mine Workers Union had amassed for the purpose of looking after their members when on strike should remain intact and be used for other things such as transporting pickets
and so on.
Such thing as a strike fund in any union. Every union has funds which it has to use to maintain its officers, pay the wages of its full-time officials, pay their pension, because a lot of unions run their own pension funds. Are you taking the taking the pension funds of their own members who are now retired to pay strike pay? You couldn't do it, and very often the rules of the union don't allow
it. But it always has done until now.
You said, you know, there was quite a lot of strikes back in 1968 and it didn't happen. There was nothing like the number of strikes back in 68 as we have today. And one of the things you have to ask is why are these strikes taking place? Now, your industrial relations bill was supposed to prevent strikes and supposed to cure all these anomalies, and it's made everything a damn sight worse.
Well, before we get onto all the strikes, though, Joe, I'd like to keep on this strike pay bit here and ask the ladies, ask the wives. Do you think, Cynthia, do you think that you should have got strike pay from your union because your husband paid subscriptions?
Well, I don't think they pay enough. I don't exactly know how much subscription he pays a week, but I don't think he pays enough to qualify for it.
So are you saying then that you don't think that perhaps the unions have been realistic in their attitude towards you?
Well, I think they're realistic.
Can I just say this? My union used to pay strike pay. We used to pay full pay. Well, we used to win every strike inside 2 days. We used to go picketing with the golf clubs on our shoulder, and the boss quit because we were paying full pay.
Then
we exhausted the funds. Now, there is just nothing left in the kitty, and this has happened more and more.
I think Cynthia's brought up a good point there.
Shouldn't
the subscriptions be more realistic? I mean, there are some men in some of the unions earning, we'll say, £50 a week, and they're paying something like 20p subscription. Yeah. Now, that's really rather ludicrous, don't you think, Joe? I mean, if the subscriptions were higher, couldn't then it be like an insurance policy, and then the strike pay would be strong, and wouldn't you be strong, and wouldn't your members be strong?
Well, this is a very good theory, but what happened in the past when they have had strike funds, they found that inflation made them useless. People don't go on strike every year, they might only go on strike every 10 years. The hospital workers have never been on strike before.
Now, if
you start a strike fund off, we'll say, for the hospital workers back in 1950, and you put £2 a week into it or something such as that, by the time you go on strike in 1973, it's worthless. And what's happened with inflation is that very often where a union has had a strike fund, 1 week's payout and it will be bankrupt. So it says rather than paying out 1 week at £5 or £10 and then nothing for the next month, why bother paying out at all?
Yes,
let me say this, Ralph Howe.
Sorry.
In no other country in the world is a system operated like this. And this
it
was not
a welfare state like ours. Yeah.
And this was not intentional. And it's only since this government has been in power that the politically motivated strike has meant that Treasury funds can be drawn on so that every strike is bound to be a winner. Now, we are all doing tremendous damage to ourselves, and nobody is winning in this. And the people who are getting hurt the most are the people who have ceased to work, the ex-workers, the pensioners, the people who can't defend themselves, the people who want to go into hospital to have some treatment. And I've got a pathetic letter in my pocket at the present time of a child of three.
Mr. Howell, I'd like to bring in another point there. I mean, you're saying, in fact, that strikes cause inconvenience to the general public. But nevertheless, I put this point to you. Should a railway worker or a hospital worker live at a low, impossible standard of living because they're inconvenienced
by
the public?
Not at all. What we should do in this country, and I'm trying to be constructive in this, and I'm not union bashing at all. What we should do is institute immediately a minimum wage, a wage at which a reasonable sized family. The average
but what
family
is the reasonable
could
wage? That's what they're fighting for. Yeah. You would rather the man on strike, he can't claim supplementary benefit, yet he can stay on a lower wage and claim family income supplement. Where's the sense?
There should be a more intelligent way of doing it than any party has yet found in this country. Personally, no government, neither this government nor the socialist government, has had the courage to look this thing fairly in the face and say we must have a minimum wage, cut out all this nonsense of bits and pieces of
Ralph,
of
even
help
with
and so
a minimum
on.
Wage, it'd have to be increased sometimes.
Of course,
you know, and then you'd still get the same problem.
No, you could. Supposing a minimum wage were set, in my opinion, nobody should be working for less than £25 per week at the present time, and if that would get
5 million a while.
Yes, I know, and I think it's quite disgraceful. If you had a £25 minimum wage,
do you pay your farm workers £25 a week? Now, Ralph is an employer.
Yes, they average. They
for a basic
Mr.
working
Howell,
week.
Look, I think we're straying
no, not
off
for
the
basic
point.
Working
I
week.
Think we're straying off the point. You're saying, you know, you're stating about minimum wages. All right, we all want a good working wage, and therefore, as Joe Ashton has said, they're not getting this good standard of living, so therefore they go on strike. Do you deny their right to strike?
Not at all. I think
can
it's
I
a
also
fundamental
put another
right.
point to you? Can I ask you whether you believe in the welfare state?
Yes, and I believe...
He only believes in it for a certain few, obviously.
No, I don't. I believe the welfare state that we have in this country is probably second to none, but it's being badly abused at the present time.
But what do you
it,
it isn't
and how?
By mainly the better-off workers, the car workers, the shipbuilders, the dockers, who are wrecking the thing, and the miners, in many respects were merely used to wreck the machine. They were urged to draw everything possible from the funds in order to wreck this
very
good
low wages
social...
for 10 years, and you expected them to take low wages forever.
Well, can I just we haven't got a lot of time left. So can I ask you this? Given that Joe Ashton's point that the unions, if they got the money, would pay the money,
the miners have got it.
Well,
if they have several strikes a year, they want to have a decent wage, what would your answer be? What would you do then, Mr. Howell, with people who haven't got money?
The unions, to be effective, and for what they were set up for in the first place, and let's face it, they've done so much good for the working man since their inception in the earlier days, and since 1906, they've done a tremendous amount to lift
it up. But you're going to keep bashing them over the head.
No, not at all.
Which is going to make strikes
now
even
by
worse.
Going on and
sorry,
on, they have ruined it.
Yes, well, I think that's obviously going to go on for a bit longer, and that in fact will give us points to consider. But until this time next week, goodbye.